Good old Watson's face.
I won't call it a senior moment because I've suffered from that for years and years. You know, I'm going to introduce somebody, write his name down. I wrote it down. Can't possibly forget that name. Walk over here 30 seconds later, and there it is. Anyway, I had the pleasure of sitting on the Citizens Review panel when Mark was interviewed and others were interviewed, and then he was selected to be the fire chief here in Auburn, and he did a wonderful job and retired a year and a half, 2 years ago. Anyway, Mark, welcome to the public forum. Come up and tell us what you have to say. I prefer to hold all the questions to the end, but if there's something that he says that you just have to jump up and do something, well, please do. But passion's important here.
Everybody hear me okay? I'm kind of losing my voice as well, too, so hopefully it stays with me. So thank you very much for the invite this morning. I know I've spent a number of years with this group early in the morning on occasional Tuesdays talking about my fire department. Today, I'm not going to do that. It's a little bit different. I'm going to talk about a fire department. Working with the Public Safety Forum, this is kind of the theme, so Bob Snyder asked if I would kind of take my experience and just kind of wrap it up. And what I want to do is kind of give you a big overview of a fire department. And I'm going to throw a little bit of Auburn in there since that's my experience as well, too. So obviously, a fire department doesn't really fit the name anymore because fire is not the only response, but you have vehicle accidents, medical aids, which is the most common, hazardous materials, false alarms, fire investigations, public risk. It's pretty much an all-risk agency. In other words, when somebody calls and needs something, send the fire department if nobody else will go. Medical, obviously, is the highest call for service. Fires average about 10 to 15%, and that's kind of an average for any fire department. The fire department organization is very paramilitary, very structured, command and discipline. There's a chain of command, and there's a span of control. Typically, there's a chief officer, executive, line officers, captains, firefighter engineers, and firefighters. That's a basic structure layout for a fire department. That seems like a pretty tight ratio. It's a one-to-one ratio. So here's a fact. Several years ago, early 2000s, OSHA came out with a regulation for fire departments. It really kind of took fire agencies for a loop, but it's called two in, two out. And what that basically means is that before two firefighters can enter into a hazardous situation, such as a burning structure fire, to go put it out, two additional firefighters have to be outside, tooled up, packed up, with communication, ready to go, and their only job is to provide rescue for those two people inside. Okay. That's a significant challenge for those agencies that only had two people on an engine company or three people on an engine company. How do you do that? I'm going to talk about that a little bit later on. So again, that one-to-one span in the fire service, that extends out to the federal level as well with the two-in, two-out, which is a one-to-one. Fire departments are very mission-driven. from the elected officials all the way down through the managers, all the way down to the troops. This is where your labor-management relationships need to be pretty tight so that everybody can follow the mission. Typically, there's a mission statement for an organization. And that's kind of like the refresher in your mind. This is why we're here. This is what we do. This is how we do it. We keep going over and over on that. fire departments are very task-orientated. They get the job done safely and effectively. There's almost an operating procedure for every type of response or incident that occurs, even down to the training level, public education, public inspections, public programs, you name it. fire departments are typically full-time, volunteer, or a combination, such as the fire department here in Auburn. It's a combination department utilizing full-time people and using non-full-time people. Approximately 20 to 25% of the daily staffing is non-full-time people. Excuse me. Operations of a fire department, this is kind of at the daily station level. Obviously, response is a big part of it. Training, prevention, public education, equipment and station maintenance, and administration. Emergency response. Everybody has a task on emergency response. And what that means is that you'll see a fire engine going down the street, and there may be three people on there. There'll be a captain that's in the right-hand seat up front. There'll be the firefighter engineer who's operating the engine, and there'll be a firefighter, maybe two firefighters in the back. Everybody has a job. The firefighter engineer needs to get that apparatus and that personnel to the scene safely. The fire captain is responsible for the overall safety of the crew and the overall initial deployment of resources. Firefighter is going to pull the necessary equipment. So let's just take a typical situation, structure fire, single family dwelling. Engine pulls up, stops at the fire hydrant. Firefighter jumps out, pulls a large diameter hose, the big hose, off the back of the engine, wraps around the hydrant. Engine goes forward, stops. Firefighter engineer gets out of the truck, hooks it up to the engine. Firefighter turns the water on from the hydrant, runs back to the engine, pulls a hose line. Those are the firefighting hose lines. Meantime, the captain's running around doing a size up, looking at the safety hazards, looking at what plan of action they're going to take. In the meantime, they're all putting their self-contained breathing apparatus on. So within 1 to 2 minutes, we have a firefighter and a fire captain that's sitting at that door, ready and waiting to go in. That's kind of the standard operating procedure. And that's how everything is kind of structured in the fire service. Same thing with a medical aid. Pull up to the scene, single family dwelling, firefighter jumps out, grabs a medic bag, firefighter engineer, make sure the truck is out of the way for the ambulance, maybe guides the ambulance in, fire captain walks in, evaluates the scene, they begin their practice. That's kind of the structure of it. That's kind of the routine. Approximately 300 hours or 15% of the time is spent in training. A lot of the training is spent on what we call low frequency, high risk situations. A fire is a very low frequency situation, but it's an extremely high risk. So something you don't respond to all the time, you spend a great deal of time training in it so that when you do respond, it's like clockwork. Get down to that 1 minute pull on the hose. Other things, swift water rescue, high angle rescue, low angle rescue, all those unique type things that are high risk but low frequency, a lot of time is spent in the training. Public education programs include pre-fire planning. This is where firefighters go out and they get to learn their district or their community. They throw inspections at the same time, so kind of it's a two-fold program where they inspect a business, but at the same time, they're pre-planning it, knowing what's there, who operates it, how it operates, what the hazards are, where to park, all kinds of things. Some of the other community programs, CPR, car seat installation turned out to be a big one, baby seat installs, defensible space and business inspections, school programs, and then just meeting with local organizations time to time. Administration, believe it or not, there's administration at the station level. Every incident that's responded to requires a fire report, okay? That's a national standard. That takes time and it takes effort to put that detailed report in. There's training logs that need to be completed. There's equipment logs that need to be maintained. Again, it's a public agency, so everything's public record. So it needs to be documented. The culture of the fire department, very professional, can-do attitude, always striving for the best, learn from each event. That's kind of the overall theme. Typically, the work periods, they work in shifts, which means 48 hours on and 96 hours off. The work environment is completely team-orientated. When you're spending 48 hours with somebody, day in and day out, you gotta have a tight team. And you got to learn to live with each other, eat with each other, sleep with each other, and respond to emergency calls with each other. That's how it functions. Everybody knows their role. The other part of that is they also watch out for each other. There's a saying that everybody comes home in the fire service, and that's really what it's all about. That's what builds that camaraderie. Also, in the fire service, that extends outside the work environment. Firefighters and the fire personnel are very social outside of work as well as in work. They carry those relationships out in the different environments, less stressful, kind of let their hair down a little bit, and kind of enjoy each other at times. Overall issues facing fire departments, 1973. Oh, thanks, Bob. Am I that bad?
No, you're not.
1973, America Burning Report, was the first federal document that came out that addressed fire issues. Typically, fire issues and fire departments are run at the state level. This is the first time the federal government got involved. They identified 90 different areas where America can improve on fire service. Of those important ones that really pertain to fire departments, firefighter safety, training, education, staffing, response, prevention, and community risk are the highest. This continues to serve as a guide to this day, almost 40 years later. Okay, some realities. No fire department can staff or respond to a major incident alone. That's a true fact. We haven't been able to do that for years, as long as I've been in the fire service. Again, the two in, two out changed that real quick for us. NFPA, National Fire Protection Association, they have recommended standards, okay, not requirements, but recommended standards that you try to shoot for. Their recommended standard for a single family structure fire is 15 firefighters arrive within 9 minutes, okay? If you put that into real world here in Placer County, that's 5 engine companies, okay? That's quite a bit. And I know over the years, Placer County has created these automatic aid responses. Before, it used to be mutual aid. Hey, we need some help, can you come out and help us? Now it's automatic. When there's an alarm of a fire, 5 closest engines are gonna go to that fire. That's how we kind of adapted and overcome in those situations. California has probably one of the best, or the best, I should say, mutual aid system in the nation, if not the world. These large incidents that occur, the 1,000 departments, local government departments in California, support both the federal and the state agencies because they can't even handle their own incidents at time. But that's how we adapt and overcome those situations. Volunteer firefighters, they're becoming a thing of the past, unfortunately, due to training requirements, which is the same training requirement for volunteer as a full-time individual. That's a lot. It's about 750 hours just the fire academy alone, plus the 300 hours a year. And then add on the physical and medical requirements, and the mere fact that a lot of people don't live and work in the same community anymore, much less be able to take off from their job at a moment's notice and keep their job when they come back. So that's becoming very difficult. For years, we as communities relied on this system, but it's no longer a viable option. Economic factors, medical aids increased with lack of jobs and health care. When we had the recession, the 911 system became their healthcare system, okay? More response to medical aids because they had no source. Pick up the phone, call 911. fire response with EMS costs. As a firefighter and a fire chief and a fire officer, I was always asked, why do you send a fire engine when you send an ambulance, okay? That is the most cost-effective way in our EMS system, okay? Back in the 70s, remember the old Squad 51? Johnny Gage, Roy DeSoto, two guys in the squad run out. Late 70s, I said, why are we sending two people out in a squad when we have three people on a fire engine? Fiscal constraints started already. Let's eliminate the squad, let's send the engine, okay? The engine is the toolbox. And wherever the firefighters go, they must bring their toolbox. Medical aid, they make run across a vehicle accident or a fire on the way back. That's why that engine goes, okay? That engine is kind of a customer fee-based, taxpayer-based service. Most ambulance companies are private-based. If anyone's ever used an ambulance before, the cost is about $2,000 to $3,000 for a trip. If the fire engine did not go, you'd probably get two ambulances that would respond, which would cost you $4,000 or $5,000. So it's a pretty good deal, the way that it's set up. I'm not saying it's the best, but that's what we've come to. Impact of call volume, 2,000 plus calls for one fire station is pretty significant. I know the Bay Area average is about 800 to 1,000 calls per station. So this is a very busy little station up here in Auburn. It represents about a 36% increase in call volume and emergency calls over a 15-year period, which is pretty significant. As a fire chief, everybody asked me, well, wow, that's a lot of calls. It must be because our population is old and you're running a lot of medical aids. Partly true, but the other part of that is that look at this community. It is very, very active, okay? We have two major transportation infrastructures, Interstate 80, Highway 49. We have huge recreational areas adjacent to us. We have events like the Tevis, Western States, even the Christmas Parade. Look at the numbers of people that brings in. Wherever you have people, you're gonna have some type of incidents. They either trip or fall or run into each other or something happens, but they rely on that. A lot of these sponsors for these events, what they do is they check ahead. They'll call. As fire chief, I got multiple calls from different event sponsors saying, what level of services do you provide? They want to feel comfortable with the level of services before they commit to an area. Human toll on firefighters. This is one that kind of sad to report, but most firefighters will spend about 25 to 35 years in the service. And not only is this a physical impact on an individual, but a mental impact. All those years of responding to someone else's emergency can take a toll. Coupled with today's fiscal constraints of reductions and doing more with less, believe it or not, suicides among firefighters on a significant upswing. And the fire service is starting to realize that and starting to implement programs to address those. Got to keep our firefighters safe, both physically and mentally. That's a big investment that we have. Expectations of the public. They expect their fire service to be professional, well-trained, well-equipped, and somebody to take care of their emergency. It's not our emergency, it's their emergency. My 37 years in the fire service, no one has ever called the fire station and say, hey, my house is on fire, can you send your best firefighter in a pickup truck with a fire extinguisher? They expect the best. All the bells and whistles, everything you got, they want it. With the call volume here in Auburn, it's about 1 out of 8 citizens utilize the service. When you look at that, that's not much, okay? So out of 8 people, 7 people, they know it's there, there's an expectation it's there, but they have no idea what it's really like. Community needs and the risks. Each community has its own need for fire service. Obviously, Sacramento has different needs in Auburn than Truckee. Auburn has significant wildland-urban interface situations, transportation arteries, aging community, recreational areas, events, residential, and commercial. Citizens and elected officials and emergency service managers have to collectively evaluate the risks to prioritize and determine what level of service will best meet these needs. There needs to be a balancing act between emergency response and the prevention and risk reduction, okay? Without prevention, response will increase. Without adequate response, you have a potential for your incidents to get significantly increased in damage, disaster, And we all know what the economic impact on the community is nowadays. It's not like it was before, but a small fire can have a significant impact, especially in the commercial area. Either way, it takes resources to fulfill the mission, regardless if it's prevention side or response side. Kind of lastly, ISO, Insurance Service Office, they have a public grading system. I think most of you are familiar with that, where they come out and they evaluate the fire department based on their response, their calls, their water system, their call handling, et cetera, and they establish a numerical number from 1 to 10. The lower the number, the better your insurance rate is going to be. That system's been in existence for a long time. It's somewhat antiquated, but it's still used. I mean, used industry-wide by the insurance companies. We still follow that. Several years ago, the International Fire Chiefs Association tried to come up with an accreditation process, which is still in use today. And it kind of covers the ISO, very similar, except they've added some other components in there. And that is, they look at the fire department and they see what type of risk assessments they've done on their community with input from their citizens, okay? So they've sat down and they've begun those planning processes to say, what are the priorities of the community? What are the risks associated? What is the plan? How are you gonna approach that? What that does is really create a basis for the future to build upon an organization. So that's my few minutes of overview of a fire department. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions after Chief Ruffcorn.
Thank you, Mark, and I really want to thank Bob Snyder for initiating this whole process. It has really been educational for me along the way, and I think it's really something that it needed to be done. I've been in law enforcement 31 years now, and the last two as the public safety director here, and like Mark said, and I should just say ditto to about 90% of what he said as far as the law enforcement services go, because we are that get-it-done mentality. I have to say, over the 31 years, the actual mission of law enforcement has changed dramatically. And I want to start off with a quote. Herman Goldstein, a professor at the University of Wisconsin, coined the phrase problem-oriented policing. He also said, changes in the last half century in policing have, regrettably, been minimal. The policing profession continues to systematically suppress innovative ideas and creative thinking, insisting instead on reinforcing tradition and conformist thinking. In the future, policing will need courageous leaders to remain viable. And I truly believe that to this day. Over the last couple of weeks, we've had an opportunity to hear a lot about numbers. So the very first slide I wanted to put up there were the two budgets from the police and fire department since 2008 and 2009. And I wanted the bottom line there is our current budgets on both sides. And it should be noted that since the lowest level back in 2009 and 10, fire departments increased about 29% and the law enforcement increased about 24%, which is significant. But I also wanted to point out that part of that 29% increase is grants and state funds that we have some really wonderful grant writer firefighters have obtained. So part of those costs are offset by revenue, and that's on both sides of the house. But as you can see, we're talking 6-7 years now, and 29-24% increase. If you project out another 27 years and see 29% or 24% or even switch them, it could be more on the law enforcement side and less on the fire side. It remains to be significant, and that's my concern as we move forward, is how we continue to pay for these increased costs, because I don't see it going down. We've heard over the last couple weeks that it is going to continue to rise, and unfortunately we don't have a lot of control over it. So in talking with my colleagues across the United States that we have, and it's really something that we need to get in front of. It needs to be something that we need to be aware of, which we all are, and that's what this forum is all about. But it's not something that we can't control as long as we do get in front of it and we make courageous decisions on what we're going to do into the future. This is the law enforcement personnel side from 2008 up until now. And as you can see, going back to 2008, you had about 26 personnel, all the way down to 20 now. And so there has been a decrease, and it fluctuates throughout where the employees were, when they lost, and so on and so on. And then the bottom couple lines there, officers left. And officers leave for a variety of reasons. Obviously, retirement. They leave because they're looking for something different, or they leave just because they don't. This isn't a profession for them. And the last thing we want to do, and Andy talked about it, training is very expensive. Andy Heath talked about it last week. But it's something that we just need to realize. And I use the analogy that when I was 21 years old, Auburn wouldn't have been a good fit for me. I love to put gangsters in jail. I love to arrest people who are dealing drugs on the corner. It's not necessarily happening here in Auburn, but it doesn't mean they're not here. They're not dealing drugs on our corner, but there is drugs in our community. There not might be gangsters hanging out in every corner, but we do occasionally see somebody who's from a gang environment here in our community. So it's something we should be aware of. It's just a different form. But one of the things I'm really proud of at the police department over the last several years is we have really recruited, and we've acquired some really talented people from other places. And that's one of the unfortunate things is the two people I've hired that were not attached to an agency, we had to let both of them go. They weren't ready for this profession quite yet. But the ones I have obtained have just been spectacular. But unfortunately, I had to take them from another agency. Their loss is obviously our gain, but that's going to continue to happen. And you read about it across the United States about the Ferguson effect, and that is true across the United States. It is getting harder and harder to find qualified people to enter into our profession. I read an article this weekend over in the news that one agency, a large agency in another state, has now stopped doing polygraph tests. That's scary to me because I need to know who's going into your house. I need to know who I'm putting out on the street that has the ability to take away civil liberties. But that's my fear for my profession. If we don't change, if we don't get out in front of this, we will become get run over by that train. And when you start reducing and lowering standards to allow people into this profession, you're only setting yourself up for failure. My former agency, we track that. We had to lower our standards a couple times during my 23-year career there. And almost to a day, 2 years later, after we lowered those standards, we saw an increase in citizen complaint and citizens and personnel complaints. And so there is a correlation there, and I know that. And that's why, as you can see, a couple times during the while I've been here and even before I came here, we lost a significant amount of people. At one time, we were down almost 25% of the people here in Auburn. As far as law enforcement officers go. But again, and my management staff will attest to this, the last thing I was going to do was lower the standards. The citizens deserve the best I can get, and I wasn't ready to concede by lowering my standards and bringing somebody in this community who doesn't deserve, and you don't deserve, to work in this line of work. Here's another quote, out with the warrior, in with the guardian. When I first started, like I said, my whole job was to hook people up and arrest them, take them to jail, don't worry about it. A homeless call wasn't on our radar. Obviously now, I read a lot. Going back to an article I read this weekend, for the first time in history, homelessness has passed criminal behavior as far as community's number one concern. And in far too many communities, the police are viewed by themselves and the citizens that they are charged with protecting as warriors occupying hostile territory. Instead, the police must act as the trusted community partners working collaboratively with the community members to make their neighborhoods stronger and safe. That goes back to the social issues that really need to be explored and really need to be addressed in our communities. Our community is wonderful. And the one thing that we do is we ask the people who we're interviewing, we want to make sure they're right fit for us, but we ask them to interview us to make sure we're right fit for them, going back to the previous story, because we want to make sure that they're not looking for something we don't have. If they're looking for nonstop action, running gun battles, they don't happen here on a regular basis. It doesn't mean they can't happen, but they're not happening regularly. But we still have law enforcement work to do, And we afford our officers the ability to connect with our community, to get out and talk with them. And again, I'm really proud of what we've done over the last couple of years, because the people we've brought on, some very experienced people from some other agencies, large agencies, really looking for that type of mentality. The actions of any police officer in an incident can impact an individual life and even a community for generations. Given this realization, every police officer must be centered on what is important: service, justice, and the fundamental fairness. These are the fundamental principles in which every guided action must be grounded. If you've looked over the last couple years here in California and across the United States, certain actions have obviously brought attention to those communities. And sooner or later, it's going to happen in our region. But the one thing, again, that we've tried to do is build up the transparency within the organization, the law enforcement organization, and to bring people into our building. We have this currently started last week. We've trained 200 people in our community through our Citizens Awareness Academy, something we're really proud of. And we started that 8 years ago now. This is our eighth class. And 200 individuals who really know what we do, know that we can't solve crime in an hour, and know exactly on a daily basis. We've had people come in there, and they were very honest. They were very skeptical about the Auburn Police Department. But when they left, they actually knew what we tried to do and why we do it. One of the things that, again, I'm proud of is we take them out on a voluntary day during our Citizens Academy to go shoot the guns that we have next door. Obviously, shooting guns is a lot of fun, and we all admit that. But there's an educational component to that. When my officer is walking towards the Bank of America with a very intimidating gun, I want our citizens to know why he has that particular weapon, why he's going in that particular manner, and what that gun can do. And that's part of that educational process. It is no fluke, though, that incarceration rates fall and crime rates rise. Over the last couple years, Prop 47 and AB 109 has really thrown a different component, and I don't want to get this political. I do believe that sentencing laws needed to change. I don't think they needed to change in this manner. Across America, everybody's seeing a decrease, except California. The Western region has seen a 6.4% increase in violent crime, which is very, very concerning to me. It doesn't seem, for a while there, it didn't seem like we couldn't go a couple days without another law enforcement officer being killed. And that, again, is concerning. It's not that this hasn't happened before and won't happen again, but the rate in which it's happening is definitely concerning. But Prop 47 and AB 109, what that did to our communities, one, it released a lot of state prisoners, sent them back to the counties, and what it did is put undue burden on the counties to take care of these things. Probation officers are now really parole officers. They did not have that type of training. They weren't used to dealing with violent, extreme people. Well, now it's basically put back on the county, and they didn't ask any of our opinion. This was just done to us. Prop 47, what that did was reduce the numerous felony crimes and made them into misdemeanors, which in all aspects, some of it should have been done. However, what that did, though, is with these drug offenders, what we used to arrest for a felony, we used to take to jail, they used to stay in jail and then go to a court, and the court would have hopefully provided them some type of mandatory rehabilitation. Now they're just not showing up. A lot of the things that we were hoping that would happen were the rehab dollars. They haven't made their way back to the county, and I don't want to speak to the county, but I know it's not happening. Those rehabilitation dollars have not made their way back into our system to really solve this problem. So what we're doing is we're out on the street running into people who we generally wouldn't run into on a regular basis. A lot of people who would generally be in some type of custody or in some type of program that are not in custody that really should be. And a lot of that burden is not just going back to the police department, but it's also going back to the fire department, because they're running into these people, whether it's a medical overdose, whether it's some type of other medical issues, and it is concerning to me. It's harder and harder now that, and there's very few consequences, and it, again, there's not a lot we can do about it, but it's something that the profession, and it's not just law enforcement, it's fire also, that we're having to deal with, that we really need to come up with some innovative ideas on how we move forward. These are some of the goals, and I'll just talk about some of the numbers specifically to both organizations, and Mark mentioned it. On the fire side, there were 2,070 calls. 1,470 of these are medical, and about 97 of them had something to do with fire. On the law enforcement side, about 21,000 calls for service, and that's down from a high of 25,000. So obviously, it's progressed down in our community. But Mark mentioned mutual aid, and I'll go back to early November last year. We had a homicide here in the city. That evening, we had two agencies respond, the Sheriff's Department and the Police Department respond out. Phone calls were made to the FBI, and eventually the State Department of Justice came out. This was a whodunit. There was no one around. We thought we had a few people who might know what happened, but generally it really came down to a whodunit. Over the course of that investigation, there were probably 100 people involved in some aspect of another. It took us about 6 weeks to solve. It ended up in a not Auburn area of Oakland, where a very serious person, very serious gang member, was arrested for that crime. That literally, we had no clue at the beginning of that, but over the course of that, 100 people were probably touched that investigation in some manner. And again, it was a great piece of police work. And it, we saw by one of our new people that we had stolen from somebody else. But again, it's one of those things that it's wonderful to see it happen. Again, it doesn't happen here too much in Auburn, thank good, knock on wood. But it could happen, it did happen, and it was a pleasure to see us hold somebody accountable for that crime. But the costs in this community are outrageous, and I would encourage you, and I tried to get it here to bring it up online, but the RAND crime calculator, R-A-N-D crime calculator, I couldn't get it up here, and so there's nothing there. But that one homicide, according to their statistics, cost $8 million. $8 million. And that's from all the 100 people who investigated it, the lab work that was done, the follow-up, the overtime, arresting those person, the incarceration, the court costs, and then the prison costs, $8 million. So if you take all of the crime that happened in 2016 in just the city of Auburn, the aggregate crime cost for our community is $26.12 million. That's a lot of money. And so, like Mark said, this prevention aspect, and again, I'm very proud of that we've gone from 25,000 calls down to 21, because I think some of the things that were happening is we are trying to do that prevention aspect, and that's one of the things that have changed significantly. But $26 million, if you put a value figure on this RAND crime calculator, does this for you, the value of one officer to this community is $638,650. That's significant, and that's a good thing. The higher that number, the better, because it means that you're starting to balance on how much we can pay for and how much they're worth. And when they cross over, that's where the communities run into problems. And we will continue to head down that line where, again, I realize it's really, really expensive to keep me employed. And I don't know how much longer. Again, we can continue to do business as usual. It's very expensive, and it's something that I think we should all be concerned of. Also, the other thing that we need to deal with, and it's a concern, we've dealt with it in my opinion, really well throughout the county, is the legalization of marijuana. Throwing a new aspect into what we're trying to do here. But again, that significantly changes the line of business that we do. People have come up to me afterwards over the last couple weeks, you know, what are the solutions to all this? And I'll be quite honest with you, I don't personally have all the solution. I have some ideas, and I'm sure you do too. However, the one thing I will stress is uncertainty cannot be used to justify inaction, and continuation of current operational strategies are not going to work. I think items like this, discourse and dialogue are needed, bold and innovative ideas are needed, courageous leadership is needed. Experimental efforts, I think, have to be tried, and I don't think we should be afraid to fail. Not fail on safety, but fail on operational ideas. And because, again, sooner or later, we're going to find something that works. And I think this goes for both fire and police. But if our professions remain passive and reactive in shaping its future, the result will be increasing irrelevance for the profession and greater vulnerability for the communities and the citizens. We cannot simply seek to preserve this mythological image of bygone days. We have to try and move forward. I don't know what that is, but I think we need to, and I'm glad we're doing this. As again, I thank Bob for putting this together, because we need to come up with some solutions. I'm concerned about the young police officer. I'm concerned about the young fireman. I want to make sure they have access to the same wonderful career that I had over the last 31 years. And people ask me, well, let's just contract out. I'm telling you right now, I'm not in favor of contracting out. I had that job right before I came here to Riverside County, and the Sheriff's Department does a wonderful job. But when you contract out, you lose local control. And I'm in favor of local control. I'm in favor of us having a decision. Now, if it was a joint powers agreement between different organizations or different cities, different entities, I think that could be explored and that should be explored. But contracting out, I don't think is right for anyone. I don't think it's right for the citizens, and I don't think it's right for the organizations. We have to continue to, like I said, move forward, and that's my presentation. Open to any questions.
Thank you very much, John. If you have questions, please make your way up to the front here, and we'll have a microphone for you. I have a question for you, John. You mentioned the Ferguson effect. Is that something that's temporary? Can we expect that to go away?
I sure hope it's temporary. But in my humble and experienced position, I don't think it's temporary. This is not the profession when I started. This is not the same type of environment. When I first started, and I had to sit in the front of the room, everybody behind me in the back of the room was a Vietnam veteran. It was a different atmosphere. And so again, the profession is not as glamorous as it used to be. It's not as portrayed like it used to be. Cops always used to be the heroes. And I talk about several times during my career those watershed moments, Rodney King, the O.J. Simpson trial. Those were watershed moments that really changed my profession. And we saw a gradual decline. And it's just not small organizations. It's large organizations that are having these problems. Society is accepting more and expecting, but I think the system is also expecting less by changing our standards. And I hope it never comes to that. But if you're asking the long answer to a very short question, is I hope it's a short-term effect, but I don't see it coming to a close in the near future.
All right. Jim Bennett here has a question.
Thank you, and congratulations. I understood most everything you said.
We've been in our Citizens Academy, that's why.
I'd like to ask two questions, and it relates more to the fire department than the police department. I think of the volunteers of the police department having a nice effect. I think of the roots of Auburn having a volunteer fire department. And I'm wondering about the role of volunteers to help with the fire department. That's one. And number two is I heard that our firefighters, bless them, have 2 days on and 4 days off. Is that right?
That's correct.
So from the community's perspective, we have a full-time fire department. From a fire person's perspective, he only works 2 days a week, which is almost like a part-time job. How did we arrive at 2 days on, 4 days off, and what ability do we have to change that if it's something you want to look at?
Well, actually, that type of shift schedule is very economical. It averages out to about 53 hours a week, which is actually over the standard 40-hour work week for most individuals. You have to remember that the 48 hours on, that's 48 hours continuously on, 96 off. 2 days on straight, 8 a.m., 8 a.m., 8 a.m. So they sleep, eat, and respond at the fire station. So 2 o'clock in the morning, call. 3 o'clock in the morning, call. Whatever happens during that time, that's their work period. Now, the 4896 is, I'd say, relatively new. I'm an old guy, so it's relatively new. It's about 25 years old. It used to be one day on, one day off, one day on, one day off. We went to the 48. Fire agencies, fire chiefs had major concern. There are some times when people are working 40 hours straight. Okay, that does come into consideration. Your other question, if I understood it right, is it's about using volunteers in the fire department as support? Yeah. That's kind of a difficult situation. We actually have support members through the association. Auburn Fire has the Hook and Ladder, which is supportive. They'll come out and do different events. On fire scenes, because of the rules and regulations, it's very difficult to get the untrained personnel out there. Now, here's a real life experience I experienced about 25 years ago. We were having a volunteer fire academy. We had about 20 personnel, and we put them on fire engines. We were going out training that night. We had 2 full-time people on each engine. We had 5 engines, and we just stacked these people in there. We ended up having a structure fire that night, and all 5 engines went, okay? So you can imagine when people look and they see these 5 fire engines, and there's 40 people standing around, okay? Only 10 of them could do anything, okay? The rest of them couldn't, okay? So that's something that you run into, is that because they can't do anything on the fire scene, and safety reasons as well, too. But there are a lot of organizations. I know Placer Hills Fire has a very active auxiliary. They come out and bring sandwiches to their folks, you know, kind of drop off, here you go, thanks, bring water, things of that nature. In there.
Kevin?
Okay, thank you. Excellent presentations. I have 2 questions for John. First of all, on the homeless question, the Chamber did a survey in October 2015, and we found a spike in complaints from business owners, both in the county and the city, regarding homelessness. And the city 3 years ago did a great anti-panhandling program. But my impression is that the county, with the shelter, it's kind of acting on its own as far as the homeless problem. And is there a possibility that maybe the city of Auburn can reach out to the county and suggest a multi-jurisdictional solution where the cities and all the law enforcement work together on a common plan to address the homelessness problem? So that's my first question. Secondly, the city did a survey of citizens. I think the number one response regarding, they really support public safety, law enforcement, and fire, but I think on the police side, the number one request was that they'd like to see the police officers, instead of in the vehicle, more personal interaction. And my experience with business owners is that if they talk to a police officer, get to know them, they're going to start to convey information about problems. So it's really better for the police department to get more information about the actual crime situations. My 2 questions. Thank you.
The first question in regard to the homeless, we are in contact with the county. Our street level officers, they took the initiative and dedicated a group of people from the Sheriff's Department and probation, and they've also involved mental health to try and address some of the issues out there. In the future, again, that's sooner or later, I'm going to have to come and ask for some more bodies, or whoever stands up here in front of you is going to have to ask for some more bodies. And because, again, it's just inevitable. We can't continue. I don't see it in the foreseeable future, but it is going to have to happen. The county is in a different position where they can say, okay, let's hire 4 deputies to deal with the homeless problem. I do think Auburn needs to dedicate somebody in the future, or when we have the resource available to sustain the position, to dedicate towards the homeless. But on a line level staff, on a street level basis, we are dealing with the county on a regular basis to try and address some of those issues as far as homeless go, because if they're doing a active enforcement out there, they're actively talking with people, then they do migrate this way, and it goes vice versa. If we're out there and we dedicate certain times of patrol, we'll go out and we'll contact a lot of homeless people, and they do migrate out the other way. And so again, it's just back and forth, but the contact is already there, and the coordination is already there. They're just, the solution is not there quite yet on exactly what we can do from a multi-agency to try and solve some of this. But again, I applaud what the county's doing out there in putting a team together of probation and sheriff's department and mental health to try and address the issues in regard to that. And I think sooner or later, a lot of cities are going to have to look at modeling something similar to what they're doing out there to try and address these issues. Again, one of the things I'm really proud of is it's really hard and to get that officer out of that car. It's not an easy thing to do. They feel sheltered in there, and they getting away from that warrior mentality and getting to that guardian mentality, beliefs, getting them out of the car. But the one thing I have heard over the last couple years from some of our own business people telling me that they are seeing our officers more, contacting them, and a lot of times, and in the middle of the night, I'll get a call saying, hey, you know, I appreciate your officer. I found his card on my door, so I know he was at least checking my building in the middle of the night from here in at the airport. But we can do better. We can do better, and again, I encourage our officers, my administration encourages our officers to make those contacts, because relationships are very, very important. Like you said, Kevin, in my profession, I am not going to be successful, or the police agency is not going to be successful, if we don't have the community support, and creating those relationships prior to the problem is very, very important. So again, I'm proud of what we're doing. Some of the people we brought on, that's their main focus. That's why they came to Auburn, to make those connections. They left large agencies, came to our city, and we are really a benefactory of that, because their philosophy is different than some of the other people's who have left, and their peer pressure is the best pressure in a lot of situations. And some of our other younger officers are seeing these very experienced officers getting out of their car and addressing these issues and making these contacts. It just spreads the message that it's a lot easier to accept sometimes if I'm looking sideways instead of looking up.
Thank you. I have a question for both of you, but I want to encourage anyone else who has a question to come forward. Now's the time to do that. While we're waiting for that, both of you have wide-ranging relationships because of your position, your experience. You go to conferences, you meet people, you talk. What have you learned that you think might have some serviceability here? Any ideas you've seen across the nation, or things that you might want to have put in play or discussed for Auburn?
Again, it's the message that I kind of sent. I was fortunate to have the opportunity my very first year as the public safety director to go to a fire conference. I've had the opportunity over the last couple of years to go to international police conferences. And the one thing in almost every situation and every course that I attended, they all have to change how we deliver our product. The product speaks for itself. Everybody realizes in this community and every other community that fire service and police services are needed. How we change and how we deliver that product has to change, or again, we're going to become irrelevant. So I think that's really, and it's just not here. This is across the United States, and that we really need to look at, because these costs that they've talked about over the last couple of weeks, are, as we can all admit, they're staggering. And how we address those, because again, the city, and unless somebody, we have somebody, child or grandchild out there who's starting Google in their garage right here in Auburn right now, We have to really look at what we have and how we pay for that in the future.
Really quickly, I'll use a real-life example, and I think it's one small step at a time is how we approach that. A real-life example here in the city of Auburn, Lieutenant Garlock and Lieutenant Pecoraro have had the fortune to spend countless hours and hours and days in my incident command classes in the past, okay? The reason being is that they're another resource for the fire department, just like the fire department is another resource for law enforcement, okay? I could probably give either one of them a ICS 215 form, and they know exactly what that is, check-in recorder form, right? But again, that's kind of one small step of how we can start working together. And in a city, when you have two different agencies, such as law enforcement and fire, that's a luxury, okay? On law enforcement issues, the last major incident that Lieutenant Pecoraro had, there were several of us fire guys standing next to him saying, hey, how can we support and assist you? Even if it was drinking water to the 400 people that arrived in Auburn or donuts or whatever it was. That's the way, the small steps is how we start closing that gap and overcoming some of those hurdles.
Our newest elected city council member, Cheryl Mackey.
Newest oldest. Now that we've gone to the public safety department model, and our fire chief has now retired, and you act as a surrogate police chief, fire chief. Tell us how that's working.
It hasn't been easy. It hasn't been easy at all. That's a great question. You know, I think from an operational standpoint, I don't think any citizen has, and this attests to the professionalism of both the fire department and the police department. As far as operationally speaking, I haven't seen any changes, and I haven't heard of any changes. The fine product that you received when Mark was the fire chief is the same product you're receiving today. And that has nothing to do with me. It has to do with the fine men and women who work at the fire department and the police department. Administratively, obviously, I think we could do better, a lot better. We have two time cards. The fire department does a time card one way. The police department does a time card another way. Public Works does a time card a third way. Just trying to refine some of those issues. And some of those small little things, I think, could create some efficiencies so that we have more time in the finance section, so we have more time in the police and fire service to do what we really want to do and get out there and do some of those prevention things. Like I said, has there been mistakes along the way in this consolidation? Absolutely. I think I could do better. I think the whole process could have been better. And like I said, I've learned a lot along the way. One of the things that Mark talked about was the ISO rating, and that was lowered in 2015 from a 4 to a 3, and that was a big deal. That was a lot of work by a lot of good people here in the city to get that done. So I know there can be successes, but I think we can do better.
Are there any other questions? All right, seeing none, I'll wrap this up a little bit. Thank you both for helping us out this morning. Don't rush off. Got a quick announcement. All this is available on YouTube. If you want to, thanks to Auburn Community Television, so it's all available on YouTube if you search Public Safety Forum. And encourage you to spread that word around. I'm also going to encourage you as something, as a young man, and when I grew up, I used to wave at police officers and firefighters as they drove by. And I want to encourage you as adults to do the same thing. When you see our firefighters and our police officers, give them a wave. Let them know we support them all the way. Thank you very much for coming. Oh, one more.
Don't serve.
On YouTube, search Auburn Community Television, and it'll pop up. Thank you very much. See you next week for the final session.